The Honorable Vice President of India, ladies and gentlemen. We welcome you, Honorable Vice President Narendra Jadhav, Member of Parliament, Rajya Sabha, Mrs. Vasundhara Jadhav, and to the right, Konark Publishers. Ladies and gentlemen, this is a really historic moment for all of us on the launch of the first book in India titled New Age Technology and Industrial Revolution 4.0, Global Public Policy Issues in Economy, Democracy, National Security, and World Peace. Member of Parliament, this is his 40th book and published by Konark Publishers. We are indeed grateful to you, Honorable Vice President, sir, for gracing this occasion with your distinguished presence. And we are thankful and all of us are delighted to be here in your company. Thank you, Honorable Vice President. And with this, we would now like to start the program. I would now like to invite Mr. K.P.R. Nair to kindly come and give the welcome address.
I would like to welcome Honorable Sri M. Vengaya Naiduji, Vice President of India, who not only accepted our invitation to be the chief guest of today's event, but also was kind enough in giving us the space for the launch. As India is on the cusp of a major technological and transformation revolution, I would like to recollect a beautiful thought Honorable Vice President of India, Sri M. Vengaya Naiduji, had shared at an event a few months back, which is of great relevance to this book, New Age Technology and Industrial Revolution 4.0, being launched today. You had said, quote, technology is a great democratic tool, which is not only an enabler, but also an equalizer and stabilizer, quote, complete. With that thought, may I heartily welcome the Vice President to this function.
Honorable Vice President Sri Naiduji, dignitaries off the stage, distinguished invitees, ladies and gentlemen, let me extend a very warm welcome to all. I am truly delighted to note that some of the best minds in our country are assembled here today. 40 MPs were also expected, but as was explained to you, there is a voting going on in Rajya Sabha, and that's why there has been a delay. So some of them may turn up later, but we decided the Honorable Vice President decided that we should go ahead with the program. Ladies and gentlemen, I really feel deeply honored, indeed blessed, to have Honorable Vice President Sri Vengaya Naiduji releasing my book today in this highly distinguished gathering. This is my, as was mentioned here, this is my 40th book, and it is very different from all my earlier works. The book being released today has a long title, New Age Technology and Industrial Revolution 4.0, Global Public Policy Issues in Economy, Democracy, National Security, and World Peace. This is not a book on technology, nor is this book on socioeconomic issues. This is a book written by a social scientist on the impact of rapidly unfolding revolutionary technology on economy, on society, on democracy, and on national security.
Ladies and gentlemen, the launch of the book, here we have the first few copies of the book being released by the Honorable Vice President of India. Truly a great moment in time. Honorable Vice President of India, Sri Vengaya Naiduji.
Sri Narendra Jadhavji, Honorable Member of Parliament, Sri K.P.R. Nair, Chairman Konark Publishers, who brought out this book. Ms. Vasundhara Jadhav, Mrs. Vandana Chavan, Srimati Sonali Mansingh, Sri K.T.S. Tulasi, Honorable Members of Parliament, and I could see a lot of intellectuals sitting in front of me. Even the Delhi University Vice Chancellor is here, and other friends who have all made it to attend this program. Today, we thought it would be a normal day, so we took a chance of having this program at 6 o'clock. But it was explained, it's not intelligence nowadays, it is artificial intelligence. So the Rajya Sabha is on. So some of the members of parliament could not make it to the program, but I have a policy that once we give a schedule, we must adhere to the schedule and go on with the program. This I have been following right from my younger days. So people often, recently I was there in a function. The organizer of the function, while incoming me, was telling, "Sir, people say that Venkaiah Naiduji is always punctual. It is not so today, because he came before time." So I always try to be there before time so that you can meet, greet people, and also the exigencies of any traffic problem or any other unforeseen things can be taken care. But now, particularly after I became vice president, I have my protocol people who always try to tell me, "Sir, no, still there is time, don't move, the other man has to come." Then because you have to go only after the Prime Minister arrives there. The Vice President cannot go before the Prime Minister. And he has to leave before the Prime Minister. One day a Prime Minister was there, we were chatting in Rashtrapati Bhavan, program is over. He was just looking at me. I asked the Prime Minister, he said, "I'm waiting for your departure," he said. I'm saying it in a lighter way. This is the problem of protocol. And also, I have been in public life for years, 42 years, meeting people, greeting people, talking with people, walking with people, eating with the people, sleeping along with the people. That has been my pastime, 42 years. 42 years is not an ordinary time. So there is a departure after I became vice president. Here there is a protocol, there is a system, everything is regulated. One way it's good. Then I found that my moving around the city for an inauguration of any program, attending any seminar, symposium, or release of books, etc., is also causing inconvenience to the people because of traffic regulation and all. So then I realized the seriousness of the problem, and I told my people that let us have a hall here in our premises, Uparashtrapati Nivas, so that the Vice President need not go out. And now, to the credit of my officers, within 2 months and I think 25 days, they could get this hall constructed. And we named it as Sardar Vallabhai Patel Conference Hall, the icon of India, the Iron Man, who is the unifier. And now when Narendra Jadhavji told me this is my idea and then he invited me, I said, "Okay, you can use my hall. And also free of cost." it's a people's service thing. So that's why I'm happy that you are all here today, this evening, for this release of this important book. At the outset, let me congratulate the author, Dr. Narendra Jadhav, for giving us a book of great contemporary relevance. Very, very relevant today's times. I'm neither a technocrat nor a scientist. But I am also a public personality who is concerned about effects, side effects, after effects of all this artificial intelligence and the new age technology. That has been rightly described by Sri Narendra Jadhav. It's an education. One of the reasons for my accepting book release functions or going to universities, addressing convocations, reaching out researchers, technology, IITs, IIITs, IIMs, NITs, going around the country from Andaman to Arunachal Pradesh, from Kashmir to Kerala. The reason is I am also trying to understand more, because I believe in the policy of you must go on learning till the end. There is no end to the learning. Till last day, you must always try to learn. Learn knowledge, not money alone. You are learning and then you are earning also. And then you have to return also to the people. Learn and return. Return means pass it on to the society. The knowledge you have acquired at the cost of the society only. We are all educated at the cost of the society. So we owe something back to be given to the people. So I have been going around and I told my staff, name this as knowledge pilgrimage. Pilgrimage is popular, no, in Indian parlance. So I said knowledge pilgrimage. Today's program also, it's a very knowledge-giving program because the book throws light on the social aspects with this new age technology. That is more, I am more interested in that. I don't have much knowledge as technology, as I told you. The emerging technological revolution that underlines the fourth industrial revolution is throwing up immense opportunities and possibilities, as well as at the same time, the unfolding transformative technology has given rise to a series of complex questions and far-reaching societal concerns. It's an opportunity as well as a challenge also. The other day, my daughter has sent me a WhatsApp. The WhatsApp, one lady, she just came out and she was saying that she's speaking in English. And within few seconds, there is a hologram went out of her and started speaking in Japanese. Same person. Yeah. Amazing. I was thrilled. At the same time, I was worried what is going to happen in future. If it's going to happen like that, then what is going to happen and all. But at the same time, you can't escape from this evolution. Whether you call it as a revolution or it's an evolution. That is going to provide you a lot of opportunities and also throw a lot of challenges. You can't ignore it. Gone are those days. I remember as a student activist, I was very active in the student days. So as a student activist, we used to take processions those days. Computers were introduced in banks at that time, banking sector. So we took out a procession protesting against introduction of computer. The slogan was automation, anti-nation. That was the slogan. I myself gave in those days. But can you think on those lines? Automation is anti-nation. Then you'll be really anti-national if you think on those lines. So how to take advantage of that? That is a problem for some of the Indian minds are suffering of that mindset. Some people in the name of this ism and that ism are not able to come out of that prism and then apply their minds to the reality of the situation, to the growing aspiration of the people, to the emerging technologies and also various opportunities. Countries which have risen to the occasion, adopted these technologies or acquired this knowledge, they are moving faster. I don't want to name any party or any ideology and unnecessarily get into controversies. I'm out of politics now. I'm retired from politics, but not tied from public life. That's why I'm here. This book critically examines and elaborates on various dimensions of the so-called Industrial Revolution 4.0. It discusses the emerging new age technology, brings out the opportunities and threats, make an attempt to identify and analyze relevant public policy issues. In the global context, the book maintains global as well as Indian perspective. I'm happy to know when Dr. Narendra Jadhav is saying that this book is going to be translated into Korean, into other languages. There will be demand. Because we are all, India is known as knowledge giver, always. We are known as Vishwa Guru once upon a time. Students from various parts of the world, they used to come to Nalanda, Takshashila, Pushpagiri, Vikramshila, all this, Ujjain. they used to come and acquire knowledge. This has been certified by historians like Pahian, Hyun Song. They all wrote about India and its wisdom and knowledge. The other day I was seeing another WhatsApp where which university was born in which year. And ours is the, Nalanda is the oldest university in the world. So this knowledge is there. This land is very fertile. This water, this air. And if you provide them an opportunity and give needed encouragement, they will all come out. So that's why this Dr. Narendra Jadhav's contribution in this regard of bringing out such a book, very thought-provoking book, it will be very useful. I'm sure that it will be translated into other languages. It raises complex issues and concerns relating to economy, society, democracy, national security, and global peace. Peace is the prerequisite for progress. If you have tension, you cannot pay attention to any work. And this technology is going to create tension and detract your attention. So what needs to be done? We must start thinking about it from now onwards. While outlining how technology can benefit humanity by increasing productivity, wealth generation, and accelerating global economic growth, it underlines that poverty could be drastically reduced, even eradicated, if technological advances are combined with appropriate public policy measures. That is the need of the hour. It also touches upon the possibility of unprecedented technological breakthroughs in sectors such as agriculture, industry, services, financial sector, education, and healthcare. Also, the emerging technology could be deployed to augment ongoing global efforts at containing the fallout from global warming and climate change. Challenges of Fourth Industrial Revolution. As regards the challenges of the Fourth Industrial Revolution, it notes that while economic growth will undoubtedly get a big boost, there may not be a commensurate increase in jobs. This is another challenge. While the global economy would be on high growth trajectory, economic disparities and social inequities may raise. This is another concern. The impact of artificial intelligence and machine learning. Referring to the wide range of artificial intelligence applications from manufacturing to space exploration, the author discussed in detail the limitations of artificial intelligence. Similarly, adoption of big data and data analytics in government and the private sector can promote cost efficiency, productivity, and innovation. With the emergence of artificial intelligence and increasing computing power, the potential of robots to support humans in their tasks has grown manifold. The new age technology provides opportunities to product innovations, cutting edge agriculture practices, and market developments. Innovations in crop genetics, organic agriculture, as well as irrigation and other infrastructure can bring about productivity improvements among small farmers. In order to make the potential benefits from technological advancements more inclusive across countries, it is imperative to close the digital divide among the nation's states. Challenges in various sectors such as infrastructure, energy, water, waste management, transportation, real estate, and urban planning could be overcome. With the emergence of new age technology, there are concerns regarding job displacements or joblessness and the need to reskill professionals who are at the receiving end. The only silver lining in all this is, quote, when physical jobs are lost due to automation, jobs for the mind open up. With our intelligence, basic intelligence, if you are able to upgrade the skills of our younger generation, as we have a demographic dividend of 65% of the Indian population is below 30 years. This is the greatest advantage India has. Coupled with that, if you are able to upgrade the skills, and you can dominate. Already you are seeing much of the multinational companies. They're all now led by Indians. You have Indira Nui, Sundar Pichai. You have Sagurthi Purna. You have Satya Nadella. You have a latest Geeta Gopinath in the International Monetary Fund. The latest World Bank chief economic advisor also is India, from India, ready. So this, there are many such examples, and so we have the great potential and we have that advantage also. We have to focus more on that. Our education system, our public policies should be aimed at preparing our generation for this situation and take lead over others. This is the need of the hour. The policy makers should take note. I'm happy that the Prime Minister also, the tech-savvy person, he gave an advice, three-line advice. He said reform, perform, and transform. Transform the nation, transformation. At the end of the day, technology or this intelligence or the research, what is the ultimate aim? The ultimate aim is happiness for the people. How to make the human life more comfortable and more happy. Mere comfort alone will not give you happiness. You have comfort, you have money, you have car, you have so many things, but still people do not get sleep. People do not get, cannot eat properly if you are diabetic. If you have BP, you have other problems. So there are other issues connected. That's why I am saying it. The science and research and technology and intelligence must be used for making people comfortable and happy. That is what is required. The book also highlights how conventional view of banking is rapidly changing. Increasingly, the traditional business model of banks and insurance companies is being challenged by the so-called fintechs and tech fins, which include a wide range of financial service providers and startups. In India, country where there are economic disparities, where there is still poverty, where there is illiteracy, you need this technology. We are talking about banking sector. When the Prime Minister suggested that we must all open bank accounts for all, I was there in the government at the time. I told Prime Minister, yes, we'll do it and complete during our tenure. Prime Minister looked at me and said, during our tenure? I said, yes, a thing which could not be done in 58 years. If we are going to complete it in our tenure, it will be good. He said, no, it should be done in lesser time. Prime Minister is Prime Minister. Everybody kept quiet. But to our happiness, within 16 months, 6.32 crore people have opened bank accounts. By the same banking staff, no OT. Everybody has done their duty. OT means overtime allowance. Not doing work on time and then claiming overtime afterwards. I'm sorry to make that comparison. It happens in some cases, not all. So how you see the transformation of the Janadhana? Some people start, there is no dearth of cynical people in our country, pessimists. People say, Eric, what is the fun of these bank accounts? Paisa nahi hai to khata kholne ka matlab kya hai? They all started saying, and there is no money, what is the purpose of opening a bank account? All those people, they realized the importance of bank account on 2016, November 10th, evening 7 o'clock, when the Prime Minister came on TV and started saying, Vayor Veno. Then everybody started asking their driver, their cook, their PA, why? Aapke paas hai to bank account hai na? You have bank account? Can I park money for... So this advancement of technology, and now we are talking of DBT, right? Rajiv Gandhi. He expressed concern, if I send 100 rupees from Delhi, only 15 rupees is reaching. Anantapuram or Thiruvananthapuram, some city name he has taken. It was of genuine concern that the ultimate beneficiaries, they are not getting the actual value that has been transferred. So now this DBT, or JAM, Janadhana account, Aadhaar, mobile, that is JAM. So if it is used properly, your entitlement, you will get it. Your scholarship, your pension, your compensation, your entitlement, directly, there is no need. There is no need to go and stand in line, wait in line. You can apply online, get reply online, should also in the coming days. And we should move in that direction, online, so that there is no line. You need not stand in line, go and meet people, greet people, shake hand, and do something in between hand. There should not be any such necessity. There should not be any such necessity. The intelligence and this technology must be used to see that there is no exploitation, there is no pilferage. Ultimately, how much, see, it's not that governments of India, various governments, successive governments have not done, they have all done very good works, new initiatives. Ultimately, the benefit to the common man, to the person, the lost man, it has not reached properly. That's why even now, in spite of so many five-year plans and in spite of so many programs and all, still country 20% poverty or 16%, whatever it is, and then 20% illiterate even today, after so many. And then still there are areas where there's some discrimination. All these things are happening. So you need to empower the people, make their entertainment reach them directly without deviation or dilution, and also avoid corruption and pilferage. That is the need of our. If this intelligence is going to help us in that direction, we should move in that direction and take advantage of the same. Improve efficiency, biometric attendance. People were skeptical in the beginning, but now it has increased output definitely. There might have been some problems. In any reform, there will be some problems. But can you stop reforms? Can you close your eyes of what is happening? We are living in an era of LPG, liberalization, privatization, globalization. The entire world is small. What is happening here will be known in Washington. And then it will have its own effect. So we have to really prepare for the situation. E-commerce. Other important issues which are dealt in the book include e-commerce and how information technology over the last decade or so completely transformed the way people generally do their shopping. The important aspect of individual privacy and the manner in which the social media has been influencing societies, economies, people's attitude, behaviors, cultures, and even their worldview also has been discussed in the book. This information is very, very important. But the social media, one side is positive. The other side, you are seeing the evil and negative effects of the same. We miss these. So information is very alluded. That's why I say information with confirmation is more than an ammunition. So you must provide the real information. If you misread some of these incidents, recent violent incidents are all attached to the social media campaigns without truth or sometimes exaggeration, blowing things out of proportion. So how to protect? That's again another problem. Can you curb it? If you put restrictions, to extent you can justify it? Or if you don't put restrictions and they create havoc in a country like India where people are sometimes led by rumors? So all these issues we have to discuss. While instant communication of information is the biggest strength of social media, one has to guard against unsubstantiated, unverified, fake information and fake news. That's also, that's another problem. Cyber security and data protection have assumed huge importance in the present era. While the web is a source of lawful activity, both personal and commercial, concerns of national security arise nevertheless, simply because the seamless functioning of the web can be exploited by terrorists to wreck. Terrorism is another threat. Terror has no religion. It has no race. Some people try to take a religious cover to protect their heinous crimes, but no religion supports terror. This has to be understood, and we have to educate the society in that manner. The terror destroy parts of civilized societies. We are seeing what is happening in the name of ISIS and other activities also. And encouraging terror has become the state policy of some of our people, including our neighbor, aiding, abetting, funding, training terrorists and causing havoc. I'm happy our neighbor Prime Minister yesterday said there are 30 to 40,000 terrorists, but he gave only wrong address, saying that they are trained in Kashmir, they are trained in your part of the country. He should understand that. He must be frank enough and take steps, because that will affect that country also. Once it's like if you believe in Indian mythology, it's like Bhasmasura. Bhasmasura, understood, no? Bhasmasura. So that's another enemy. With this cyber technology and all, what will happen? How would that activity can be contained? That has to be. The world over, any country can be attacked remotely. Such attacks can cause widespread damage to telephone networks and even bring down aircraft flight control systems. As communities, societies, citizens increasingly migrate to digital and online platforms, it is clear that data is going to be at the center of all human activities. In these times to come, hence it is imperative for the countries to join hands and form international alliances in protecting and sharing data. There is an urgent need to develop a multilateral data sharing framework that is based on the principles of adequacy and also reciprocity. Of course, the primary issue of formulating a multilateral privacy framework for data sharing at the regional, continental or global level remains the same: alignment of a nation's right to territorial sovereignty with global cooperation. I wholeheartedly applaud Dr. Narendra Jadhav. I'm happy that he's my colleague in my house, upper house. And I compliment Dr. Jadhav and his team for coming out with this timely book on one of the most pressing issues concerning India and the rest of the world. This book will be useful not only for tech-savvy people, but also for policy makers. I commend this book for public reading and suggest that all libraries and various universities and technological institutions, public bodies, they should subscribe to this and then pass on the knowledge to the people. Thank you very much. Namaskar. Jai Hind.
Ladies and gentlemen, the Honorable Vice President of India, may we have a big round of applause once again. May I request Mrs. Vasuna Jadhav to kindly give the words of thanks to the Honorable gathering. Thank you.
Namaskaram, ladies and gentlemen. It's a great honor for Dr. Jadhav and me to be in the company of this august audience. Respected Vice President Garu, me intiki avana kadaniki mariyumi hospitality. Danyavadalu. We are greatly honored and touched. We are greatly honored and touched by the warm hospitality that we have received today. And I sincerely thank you, sir, for taking time out from your busy schedule to release the book, New Age Technology and Industrial Revolution 4.0. I also take this opportunity, Honorable Vice President, for the speech that you have given. You have given us new insights into this new age technology and how to take it forward. I thank Mr. KPR Nair and the Konark team for beautifully producing this book in a short time. Being a librarian by profession, I can definitely say that in terms of production value, as well as the content, it will compete with best in the world. I also wish to recognize efforts put in by Mr. Kazim Rizvi and Dialogue team in providing research assistance. Thank you, Dialogue. I also thank team of Dr. Jadhav's office for relentlessly working on the production of this book. For last few months, nobody had any other life than being involved in the new age technology, including me. Thanks are also due to the staff of the Vice President for helping us at every stage in the organization of this program. And a big thank you to all of you for being a great audience and also for being with us at this milestone of Narendra's life, that is at the book release of his 40th book.